This video is about dynamic programming. To understand what dynamic programming is, we will use it to solve the knapsack problem. The knapsack problem considers a set of items, in this case fruits, that have a weight and a value. Assuming that we have a knapsack with a fixed capacity, for example 500 grams, we ask for the set of items that fits into our knapsack while maximizing the total value of items in the knapsack. The input of the algorithm consists of the items and the capacity of the knapsack. We could take the melon, filling up our knapsack completely and resulting in a total value of 30. This solution is clearly not optimal. Instead, we could also take the banana, the grapes, and the apple, resulting in a value of 37. Here is a recursive algorithm to solve the problem. Let's go through it together and look at a slightly smaller example where we do not consider the grapes, the strawberry, and the pear. The recursive algorithm takes as its input the items that can be added and the remaining capacity of the knapsack. The capacity is 500 grams here. If there are still items left in our list, the algorithm evaluates what happens if we take or do not take the first item. First, we take the apple into our knapsack and call the knapsack function again with a reduced capacity and without the apple in the item list. We can then add the value of the apple to the result of this computation. Next, we consider the quality of the solution if we do not take the apple. In this case, we do not have to reduce the remaining capacity for the recursive call, but we can also not add the value of the apple to the solution. Finally, after we have done both computations, we return the maximum of the two. Because we can branch into two recursive calls and check for every element if want to take it or not, the runtime of the algorithm is 2 to the power of n, where n is the number of elements. One technique to improve this algorithm is called memoization. In memoization, we try to avoid duplicate computations by storing intermediate results. For the recursive algorithm, we can make the same computation multiple times. This can happen, for example, when two fruits have the same weight. Let's say that the apple and banana are both 80 grams. Then there are two subcomputations that are the same. They occur when we take only one of the two fruits. For both subproblems, we will recurse further, leading to unnecessary computations. Let's see how memoization can help us with this. Note that the code is almost the same as for the recursive algorithm. The differences are highlighted here. To keep track of the already computed solutions, we store them in a dictionary. This dictionary acts as our memo. For the first call, this memo is empty as we did not compute anything yet. We pass it to every recursive call that we execute and it will contain more and more results while we progress with the algorithm. For every call, we test if we already know the result by checking if it is in the memo. New results are added to the memo after they are computed. While this algorithm is able to store intermediate results, the amount of memory that we need can be very big. If we are unlucky, then every recursive call is different and we can never make use of the memo. This also means that in the worst case, the runtime is not better than for the recursive algorithm without memoization, which was exponential. Let's look again at how the algorithm computes solutions for subproblems. We can build a directed dependency graph for the problems that the algorithm solves, here depicted on the right. In this graph, nodes represent a subproblem and there is a directed edge from A to B if the solution for A depends on the subproblem B. The computations continue until they reach the base case and can be evaluated directly. With memoization, we were able to identify subproblems that we already solved, thus eliminating the need for duplicate computations. In the graph, nodes that represent the same problem are implicitly merged. Our dependency graph now becomes a directed acyclic graph, which is typical for dynamic programming. With memoization, we already saw our first dynamic program, to be more precise, a top-down dynamic program. Top-down because we start with our given problem and compute subproblems consecutively. In our dependency graph, we proceed from top to bottom. Instead, we can also build the solution by computing smaller subproblems first, in a manner that we call bottom-up. To make the example easier, let us assume that the weight of our fruits is a multiple of 100 grams. The dynamic program also uses a memo, but instead of storing results for calls that we have already seen in a dictionary, we keep track of them in a table. In this table, every row represents a list of fruits that we can choose from, starting with the empty list. The columns stand for the different total weights of any set of fruits we choose, up to the capacity of our knapsack, 500 grams. Every cell will hold the result for the maximum value that we can get with the fruits of its row and a knapsack the size of its column. Initially, all entries are zero and we update them row by row from top to bottom and column by column from left to right. Once an entry was updated, its content is the final solution for its subproblem. Here, we already computed some entries and now proceed in the third row. Compared to the previous row, we now have the option to pack the banana in our knapsack. The active cell then has to compute the maximal value for a knapsack with capacity 200 grams. As with the recursive algorithm, we have two choices to consider. If we do not take the banana, we can look up the result of the smaller problem with the same capacity and take that value. If we take the banana, we take up 200 grams of the capacity of the knapsack but can also add the value of the banana. We update the cell by taking the maximum of both options. This is very similar to how we computed the solution for the recursive algorithm before. Here is the code for the dynamic program. The difference is that we have already computed the results for smaller subproblems and can access them directly instead of recomputing. The algorithm proceeds until we reach the bottom right corner, which will contain our final result. In the next row, we consider the orange, which has a weight of 100 grams and a value of 12. Stop the video here. What is the value for the next cell? Lastly, we look at the melon, which has a weight of 400 grams. After having done all the computations, we finally have the result in the last cell. Observe that this procedure only works because the weights are multiples of 100. If they were not, then we could not simply look up the solution for a smaller knapsack by subtracting the weight of the current item, as we might not have a column for this value in our table. Further, the runtime of the algorithm directly depends on the size of the table, as we do a constant amount of operations per entry. It is n times the number of possible capacities that we have to check. This depends on the value c that is given for the problem. Let's summarize what we learned in this video. We started looking at the knapsack problem and used a recursive memoization algorithm that stores results for subproblems that we already solved. We refer to this algorithm as a top-down dynamic program because it constructs the solutions for big problem by assembling smaller solutions. Next, we looked at a bottom-up dynamic program for a simplified version of the knapsack problem where weights are multiples 100. Here, we can construct the solution by starting with smaller problems and using their solutions to solve bigger problems. To store the results of these computations, we use a table that we complete row by row and column by column. Thanks for watching this video.